Okay, so all I did was kind of move over all the graphs to start at the new board area. So we can look at these. We left off talking about that long run aggregate supply again, this kind of this horizontal function. I always think it's kind of important to go back and talk about demand again real quick, and that's why I said we'd come back to that demand graph. So we separated out long run aggregate supply, aggregate supply into a long run and a short run. Why did we not separate out aggregate demand? In reality, actually, you do. You do separate aggregate demand into a long run and a short run. In the short run, again, we expect it to be absolutely identical to the supply and demand model you learned in Econ 1900. That if price goes up, you would buy less. What about in the long run, right? Again, when we were talking about long run aggregate supply for firms, we were saying, let's think 10 years into the future, 20 years in the future, 30 years in the future, and we said firms probably aren't going to make any decisions based on price. Consumers, however, will. In the long run, consumers are going to have the exact same belief they do in the short run. They're going to say, hey, price goes up, quantity goes down. And if I anticipate prices going up, quantity is going to go down. And we kind of think that again at those same kind of 10, 20, 30 year increments. So we actually kind of think that the long run and the short run aggregate demand both probably look fairly similar. They're both going to still be downward sloping. They're both going to follow the law of demand. Now, they might have different slopes. If you remember to Econ 1900, we talked about elasticity and how elasticity changes over time, that it probably over time will flatten out a little bit. It might a little. I don't know if that's enough to really kind of redraw our whole model. So it has become pretty much the norm to kind of, you know, concede that, yeah, there is a short run and a long run aggregate demand, and yeah, they probably look a little different, but not completely strikingly different like this, like we got the supply. Long run aggregate demand, it might be a tiny bit flatter. And I think if I recall, most everyone hated elasticity in Econ 1900, and if you took intermediate micro, you hated it then too. So why on earth would we want to bring elasticity into a macro class? We don't. So we are just going to make that simplification assumption that, yeah, it's going to be about the same function. So this is both long and short run aggregate demand. Okay, so now we've got these three graphs that, again, all are represented on the same axes. And we want to be able to effectively combine them. So let's do the easy part of it first. So first of all, let me just kind of go ahead and make my graph here. The easy part is the part that kind of looks like our macro model. There's my aggregate demand. There's my aggregate supply in the short run. And yep, they make an X just like my model did in Econ 1900 and in our basic micro. We got to figure out what to do with long run aggregate supply. Where is it going to go into this model? So usually I ask the class, I'll be like, okay, where do you guys want long run aggregate supply to go? And the one or two people who actually are willing to speak, but everyone thinks it, says, I want it to go right here in the middle of the X. And then I always say, okay, that's great. Why do we want it to go right there in the middle of the X? And then I usually get silence. It's like, it would make it a lot prettier. It would kind of look like one of the little star. You know, it doesn't seem like we have a good answer other than it seems like it should go in the middle of the X. Well, your intuition is actually correct. It does go in the middle of the X. The question kind of becomes why. Let me draw it in and then we'll do story. So I'm gonna put it in the middle of the X. Again, still vertical. And I'm gonna, real quick, I'm just gonna kind of come over here and I'm just gonna call this, you know, CPI 1 for right now. And then again, we got this Y star, but if you call it Y1, Y star, whatever, that's fine. So why right here in the middle of our market? Essentially, there's a theoretical econ one and then kind of a think about it this way one. So let me give you the theoretical econ one first that probably no one will like, but that's okay. Essentially, it's kind of this view that in the short run, if our model was in equilibrium at this price level, this is what people would be willing to buy. And thus, that's what firms would be willing to sell. Again, this model loves intermediate or principles of micro. And thus, our equilibrium is kind of the invisible hand pushing us to that point in the short run. Generally makes sense. Then the model says, well, what if nothing changes? What if nothing changes and the CPI stays constant? Well, then if the CPI stays constant and everything else in the micro world, ceteris paribus, stays constant, why would it change production in the long run? We would have the same number of people buying the same number of goods at the same price. We had already reached a point of market saturation, kind of where everyone got the good that wanted it. So if that was true in one day and there was no change in anything, it would be true the next day and the next month and the next year and 10 years and 20 years and 30 years. Man, that's holding a lot of things constant, but it does kind of make sense that if the model is stuck in this kind of equilibrium, if we've established this equilibrium, this is what we like today, and nothing changes, there is no reason to expect in the future that we would not transact in the long run at the exact same spot, meaning giving us a Y value, right? Again, if this was a principles graph, it would look kind of like I would have a little dash down, right? And I'd have some Q. So if we establish that that's the Q we like, and it's appropriate Y with it, it's tied to Y, today it would be the same, tomorrow and forever, if there was no outside forces pushing on this model. Okay, so that's kind of maybe the econ way of thinking about it. You also can kind of go with the idea that in just kind of the philosophical way of thinking about it, the short run has to turn into the long run eventually, right? And we think that the short run will become the long run, and in order to make it to the long run, you have to go through the short run. And again, kind of philosophical kind of take on it, that at that exact point, our behavior transitions from a short-run behavior to a long-run behavior. Again, I don't know if that way is kind of easier for people to think about. To me, it's really not. I like the first way, which is why I can build it a little bit better. But I definitely have noticed that people who aren't as kind of empirical kind of take that philosophical approach, and it works for them. It doesn't really for me, so I apologize if it doesn't come off as well as the econ way. That's just kind of what makes more sense to me. So we have now right here our starter graph for the aggregate supply and demand model. So again, anytime you see a question that says show using aggregate supply and demand analysis, this is how our model starts. One of the things that we like about this model is it is capable of showing both short run and long run changes at the same time, right? It's got multiple curves. It's got long and short run, and yeah, they're the same thing, but it's got long and short run. So we can actually show both economic growth on this model and business cycle activity on this model. We usually try to not show both at the same time. I don't show both at the same time, but we could. In fact, this model is capable of capturing multiple changes in it at once. So that's what we want to kind of, I think, go to is you know, say, how does this model change? And there is something that is very important to kind of note before we get too far into this. We need to know the tenure of the change. How long does the change last? Is it a temporary change or a permanent change? If it is a temporary change, only the short run functions will change. The long run function will not. So I should give myself a little more space. So temporary changes, just some indicators, and again, we'll work through more of these and stuff as we kind of go. First of all, look for the word shock. That is an economic word for temporary, by the way. I don't know why or how that happened, but if you ever see some kind of shock, it is telling you it is a temporary change. Look for the business cycle tie-ins. So look for those business cycle words, recession, expansion, you know, anything kind of that leads us to that, again, that something is not going to last on a permanent basis. Cyclical, pro, counter, again, any of those words that we tied to the business cycle earlier, you could probably look at that. Also, maybe some indication, again, and maybe it ties to the business cycle, look for things like unemployment. Probably a temporary indicator. While it's true that we might have some permanent measure of unemployment in society, we tend to think that deviation away from that is probably only temporary. You know, we had unemployment of 11% in 2009, but it changed in 2010, and the start of this year it was 3%. Right now it's at 5% as we've seen a really rapid spike. Yeah, so anything like that that's going to have any of the kind of volleying features. And again, we'll probably add more to this. So this is not an end-all, be-all list, but it's a good kind of starter list. For permanent, we kind of go back to that default, same default we had for solo, that we consider something lasting 30 years to be permanent. So if it's starting to get to that 30-year mark, consider it permanent. Again, we don't have an exact time, like it has to be this many days, but that's kind of our gist. So kind of think about that time. We think technology is always permanent. Even if we stop using it, it's not like the technology just went away. We still have the technology to plug a phone into the wall at our house. No one does it anymore, but it's still there. It's still in existence. And honestly, it's that technology of plugging the phone into the wall that allowed for other technologies to expand and develop from that. First, it was the plug into the wall with no cord on your phone, and then don't even plug it into the wall at all. So we tend to think that technology has some measure of permanence to it. And again, we'll kind of probably mesh with some of these other ones as we go through, but I wanted to start doing some of the model changes with it so we can see how we time.
12:40.
Okay, so why don't we try, let's at least do one, and then we'll probably have to stop the video for download purposes. So let's just kind of do a quick one here. Let's do a temporary spending shock. So right off the bat, we got temporary, we got shock. Both of those are probably very good indicators of here. Honestly, spending is too. It's very rare that you would always keep spending that it would be a permanent feature. So, but that's okay. We've got a couple of identifiers. I'm gonna do my basic starter graph here. Okay, so a temporary spending shock. I guess I have to say what it did. Where we increased spending. So a temporary increase in spending shock. Okay, so we said we probably want to capture spending most likely with our aggregate demand. It's going to be temporary, so I'm only going to shift aggregate demand. I will not shift my long run function. And I would have some new AD2 curve right here. Now, this is one thing that's kind of a little different in this model. Because I am not changing my long run function, my Y star value does not change. Instead, we have a value that shows deviation from Y star. We can give this a letter name if you guys want. There is no actual point name for this, so I apologize. But just for simplicity, why don't we just call it point X? So here's point X. because we didn't see long run or potential GDP change, the deviation away from that Y star to point X represents only a temporary change. This represents a business cycle expansion right here, where point X effectively is the peak of that business cycle. You'll also notice that if there is a temporary boost in spending, it's probably going to drive prices up. In this case, we have an expansion and inflation occurring at the same time. Now, if you remember when we were looking at some of our graphs, remember that homework that we had our graphs on? Remember the inflation one? That one was kind of the weird one. It was hard to tell. Was it pro-cyclical or counter-cyclical? Because at times it kind of did both. For a large chunk of the graph, it matched up pro-cyclical, but we definitely had some issues where that wasn't the case. Here we see a pro-cyclical relationship. So if we have an expansion brought about by aggregate demand, we have a pro-cyclical relationship between inflation and real GDP growth rates. So we have kind of at least our first basic look and change.
One, two, three. Jumping off the porch like mom's not home. Tell me why the best things feel so wrong. Summer nights, love them how they take so long. Run with the feeling of being alive.